I think the discovery of how Penn influenced me and impacted me is it happened after I left the school. When you come to a school like this and a campus like this, you're just surrounded by a really eclectic, diverse people. You know, all that, it's an accumulation of all those moments here at school and all the people that I've met and friendships I've maintained, and has just informed what kind of person I am and what kind of artist I am.
I first got the Penn back in 87. Gavin was, sort of larger than life with the great Penn defenses from the 80s. You know, he won three consecutive championships at that time. And as a young coach coming on in, you heard about the great teams and the great players, and he was definitely one of them.
So we were in preseason of my sophomore year, and Gavin was a junior. And Coach Berndt, the head coach at the time, was trying to find ways to get me on the field. So he decided to put me on the wing of PAT field goal. And on the snap of the ball, Gavin literally ran right through me, knocked me backwards, stepped on my shoulder pads, ran past me and blocked the PAT. And I'm lying on the ground not knowing what happened to me. And Coach Berndt looked at the running back coach and he said to him, "Get Cosmo off of PAT. He's not on PAT anymore." And so that was my first run-in with Gavin.
Gavin O'Connor is sort of a Clark Kent Superman type character. You know, walking on campus with him the first time I met him, unassuming, soft-spoken, that New York accent. But then you see him on the football field, and the first thing that strikes you is that big neck collar that he had. I mean, who wore neck collars? Jim Otto in the 70s. And the second thing was, when you see a linebacker wearing number 20 with those white sanitaries pulled up, you know, you knew that he was a force to be reckoned with.
When you really look at the films that he has done, from Tumbleweeds to Miracle to Warrior, even to The Accountant, what's very unique about Gavin's material is it's all very, very heartfelt. And I thought, how does a filmmaker who's known for being such a macho guy always find a way to make his audience cry? And it occurred to me that Gavin is one of those unique individuals who leads with both his chin and his heart.
When I think of the name Gavin O'Connor, I think of a very special person in my life. A man of complete integrity, honesty, full of love. A guy who, amazingly, in a film business full of sharks, believes everybody's Nemo or a guppy. Gavin, sorry, I've got a background artist. Gavin, I love you so much, mate. I can't think of a person who deserves a tribute more than you. I love you so much, mate. I'm so glad I met you in my life.
One of the fascinating things about Gavin is he comes from, his father was a cop. He has incredible stories about what he witnessed as a child, seeing his father and his father's friends do. It's this sort of pretty macho, tough New York City cop world. And yet Gavin has this tough masculinity to him, but he also has this incredibly sensitive, compassionate, empathic side that's all through his work, all through his scripts and his films, is this incredibly interesting combination of macho, masculine, tough guy dynamics in the world, in the real world, and inside of that, this tender, soft, compassionate, understanding x-ray into the heart of a human being.
You know, integrity, family, loyalty, his roots, where he comes from, having a deep love of his father. I think he takes great pride in his heritage and how that's sort of influenced and affected him in every other area of his life. One of my favorite things about Jack and Gavin as I was getting to know him was that we would call him on the phone all the time when we were in LA and he was in New York, and we'd be driving up the PCH, and every time he answered the phone, he would answer the phone like this, "My boy." And that kind of love and passion for his son that he had is something that Gavin has definitely taken into his role as a father, I think, is something really special that he got from Jack and continues to live into with his girls.
How does one measure a man? Maybe it's always been measured in stones or a great gust of a northern wind. measured in smiles or tears, or the plucked strings of an ancient Celtic harp. Years turn to toil, like a great Irish poet, toil of dreams, dreams measuring the strength of a man, and always a new horizon of hope. I watched for many years he possessed the greatest gift, for he shared the givings, call it anything you please, gift of fire, hawk of battle, gift of wings, strings of the Irish harp, and always a new hope, daring to let other men dream. You know, I'm living my dream. And I'm not even talking about just work, my career. I'm talking about my wife and my children. I am so blessed to have just, you know, happiness and joy in my life with my family and love, deep love. So I'm blessed.
All right, so what do you think of this thought I wanted to entertain you with?
All right.
It's a film about my life.
How do you want it to end then?
Well, I want you to make me out to be like a hero.
Right.
But at the same time, I want you to make people cry at the end.
You want tears at the end?
I want tears.